Good evening, everyone. Before we get started, I want to let you know that we're in webinar format tonight, so everybody's camera and microphone are automatically turned off to ensure that everybody can hear the program appropriately. If you have questions throughout the evening's program, you're welcome to use the Q&A icon at the bottom of the screen, and we will have time at the near the end of the session to answer some of these questions. This webinar is being recorded, and all registrants will receive a copy of the recording following the event. I'd like to begin by introducing myself. My name is Kevin Haigis. I'm the Chief Scientific Officer at Dana-Farber and an Associate Professor of Medicine at Harvard Medical School. I'm relatively new to Dana-Farber. I started immediately pre-pandemic in January of last year. And prior to that, I had been a faculty member at Massachusetts General Hospital and Beth Israel Deaconess Medical Center. And I'm often asked, why did you want to move to Dana-Farber? And having been around the block a little bit, there are three things that really stand out to me as a member of the Dana-Farber faculty and a member of the Dana-Farber leadership at this time. The first is that absolutely, without a doubt, science is more valued at Dana-Farber than it is at other academic medical centers. Dana-Farber understands the financial and technical barriers to innovation, and we help our investigators to overcome those barriers. And I say this as someone who throughout my entire career has wanted to come to the Dana-Farber. Dana-Farber investigators are the absolute best in the business. From laboratory science to translational science to clinical trials, our faculty excel, and they do so better than anyone else. And so it's a real honor to be the Chief Scientific Officer, and it's a real pleasure to be a faculty member at Dana-Farber as well. The topic of tonight's webinar is the future of precision medicine, delivering the right care at the right time. Now, precision medicine in its very simplest form is using aspects that we can measure about an individual's disease to choose the right treatment for that person. And we're going to talk today about how this works, how we apply it in the clinic, and what the future of precision medicine might be. This area of research is a key priority in our recently announced $2 billion fundraising campaign. And it's such a critical focus for the campaign because precision medicine is really the future of cancer care. And unless we invest heavily now, we'll be behind the times when it comes to the development of new precision medicine approaches. Dana-Farber has already been a leader in this area, and you're going to hear about some specific examples of that today. For example, the development of inhibitors of the epidermal growth factor receptor in lung cancer, or the establishment of cancer genotyping through our profile system. Before we get to that, we're going to hear from a patient of Dr. Yanni. Her name is Sila Hanninen. And she is currently benefiting from precision medicine therapies, and she's offered to share her story with us.
Hi, my name is Sila Hanninen. I'm 39 years old. I'm one of Dr. Yanni's patients at Dana-Farber Cancer Institute. I currently live in Denver, Colorado with my husband and our two-year-old Bernedoodle Merlin. I am not joining today from Denver and unfortunately couldn't be there live, but happy to share a little bit about my story, my diagnosis, and my experience to date with precision therapy. I was diagnosed June 30th of 2017 with stage 4 EGFR lung cancer at the age of 35. Like most 35-year-olds that are non-smokers, I knew very little about cancer, about treatment options, and really where to even begin. I did a lot of research quickly, and through many recommendations came upon Dr. Yanni and his team at Dana-Farber, who I was able to meet with within a week of my original diagnosis. After a few conversations and discussions on which option would be the best for me, we decided that my best first line therapy would be the Tagrisso and Iressa combination trial. I was very interested in a trial option at the time because I wanted to, one, help provide more data for research, but I was also very grateful that there was an option available that was something more than just what was available more broadly. We started on that therapy in July of 2017, and by November, I ran the 2017 New York City Marathon, and by the following June, on the year mark, I completed a half-distance Ironman race. Since then, I have been on the Tagrisso in combination with a few other treatment options, currently an Alimta IV with Tagrisso, and I'm grateful every day for the limited side effects that I experience and the fact that I can continue living a very active lifestyle in Denver. We hike, we ski, I run almost daily, and I don't think that that would be possible if it weren't thanks to the advancements in precision therapy and the fact that they are more widely available now as first-line therapy. I, in every way I can, support Dr. Ghani and his research and the Dana-Farber team. I am committed to fundraising and helping continue drive research forward. I think it has been crucial in my and I know it will be crucial in treatment for many, many millions to come. I hope you all have a wonderful conference and am happy to answer any questions if anyone wants to reach out with anything I can help.
That was really great. We realized the volume was a little low on that. Just keep in mind that everybody will be able to view the video again afterwards if you had difficult time hearing it. But Sila's story is really inspirational. It's not unique among patients at the Dana-Farber, but it really emphasizes why we do what we do at the Dana-Farber. We do it all for the patients. So our panelists tonight are all faculty members at Dana-Farber who are experts in precision medicine, and they are going to introduce themselves before we get to the discussion. Misha?
Yes, hi everyone. My name is Misha Beltran. I am an associate professor of medicine here at the Dana-Farber Harvard Medical School. My clinical and research has focused on prostate cancer, but also extends across cancer types within our precision medicine program. I'm the director of translational research in medical oncology at Dana-Farber.
Thanks. Posse?
Hi, I'm Posse Yenne. I am the director of the Low Center for Thoracic Oncology. And maybe unlike Kevin, this is my first job and only job. I have been here a lifer, trained here, and have stayed here ever since because it's been a wonderful place where I've been able to combine medicine and science and see how science can benefit medicine and how it can learn from patients and develop new scientific hypotheses that we can take to the clinic.
Thanks. And Matthew?
Like Posse, I've been at Dana-Farber for a long time. I joined the faculty here in 1998, and I serve as the director of the Center for Cancer Genomics, together with Bruce Johnson, and professor of genetics and medicine. You know, it was extraordinary to hear the story of Dr. Yane's patient a moment ago, and I just felt really grateful for the type of care that our colleagues are given to our patients, and grateful also to Dr. Yane and Dr. Johnson and others for just an extraordinary decades of collaboration in lung cancer genomics, where, among other things, We discovered the EGFR mutation that Dr. Yane's patient had. And then Dr. Yane and Dr. Gray and others really spearheaded the new generation of therapeutics exemplified by Tagreso. So just feel so fortunate to be here with such wonderful colleagues and having the chance to advance cancer medicine together.
Thanks, Matthew. Tell us more about that. Tell us about the early days of precision medicine.
Sure. So I think, in some ways, precision medicine at Dana-Farber goes back a long time, and genetic medicine, an early discovery, honestly preceded, we say we're long timers, but going back to the early 1990s, Richard Kolodner, as a professor, discovered a set of genes. He was studying biology of yeast, and he discovered a set of genes that controlled DNA repair. These genes turn out to be very frequently mutated in colon cancer. Patients with this type of colon cancer have just recently been shown, thanks to investigations at Dana-Farber and elsewhere, to be responsive to chemotherapy. And Dr. Kolodner actually started as well the first precision medicine initiative at Dana-Farber, which was called something like the Laboratory for Molecular Diagnostics. When I joined the faculty in the late 1990s, there were a lot of us, Dr. Bill Sellers, Dr. Nelly Polyak, and others, with a strong interest in the new technology of the cancer genome and how we could apply human genomics to understand cancer. Bill Sellers focused on prostate cancer at the time, Nelly Polyak on breast cancer, my laboratory on lung cancer, and there were many others as well. And as I mentioned, we started a collaboration with Dr. Johnson and Dr. Yane, starting when he was an oncology fellow in training. And we all worked together to study the genomes of lung cancers. And really our finding of EGFR mutation spearheaded a range of major genetic discoveries leading to new treatments. And immediately after our original discovery, Dana-Farber and MGH together started initiating EGFR gene mutation testing, and that led in turn to the profile test, a test for several hundred cancer genes that's been available to patients at Dana-Farber now for nearly a decade and has really transformed their diagnoses. Thank you.
Thanks, Matthew. Posse, tell us how one goes from a mutation in a tumor to a precision medicine therapy.
Well, I just to echo on what Matthew said in the original or early days of discovery, the discovery actually to some degree came from the clinic, also from the clinic. It was studying patients treated with EGFR inhibitors and noticing that some of them were so what we would call exceptional responders, meaning that they had a dramatic response. And then by studying those patients and sequencing efforts that Matthew was doing, the same genetic alterations were found in the exceptional responders and in the sequencing efforts that Matthew and Bill Sellers were doing. So I think we always think about the genetic discoveries lead to therapies. Sometimes the therapies lead to the genetic discoveries as well. And I think there are still examples like that, that we see individuals who have outstanding or outlier responses, and we learn about biology and medicine that way. But a lot of effort, of course, we have systematic profiling efforts. We look for a multitude of genetic alterations in individuals' tumors. And of course, if you have a genetic alteration, the process of how you validate that and sort of credential it as something that you could target is much better now than it was 20 years ago. But ultimately, you need a drug. You need a drug that potentially inhibits it directly or inhibits the pathway that it activates. And that's, of course, these can come from commercially available agents, from our pharmaceutical industry collaborators, or from internal chemistry efforts that we have at Dana-Farber. And again, it's one of the strengths of our institution that we can take discoveries, genetic discoveries, all the way to a therapy inside our four walls.
EGFR is not the only successful target in lung cancer, right, Posse or Matthew? Can you talk more about other oncogenes that can be targeted in lung cancer patients?
Sure. I can take that on first, right? So the at the moment we have now 8 unique genetic alterations where we have FDA approved drugs all matched against a specific alteration found in lung cancer. The same basic principle that's followed from the original EGFR mutation discovery, including just the approval of the first KRAS inhibitors, KRAS G12C inhibitors, which make up a substantial percentage of lung cancer patients that was just happened over the last few weeks. And we're not done yet. There are other ones that are likely to come. So, and this is of course extended, not just in other subsets of lung cancer, but across a broad variety of cancers.
I just want to emphasize one point that Dr. Yane just made, which is, we're not done yet. We've identified many other gene alterations, some in the same pathway as EGFR and KRAS, some that are different that might allow us to do combination therapies that could improve treatment further and minimize resistance. And over the next decades, I think all of us look forward to developing and seeing the benefits from the development of those. I just want to make one more point that goes back, I think, the type of collaboration that Posse and I have had, that goes back to a comment, Kevin, that you made in the introduction. And I think Dana-Farber is lucky. We have a lot of physicians who really care about and respect science and really understand the importance of science in medical care. And we have a lot of scientists who really care about and respect cancer medicine and understand the importance of learning from patients in our research. And I think that combination, that we have that mutual interest from both sides, is what's really helped us uniquely bring forward discoveries that help patients. And the example of, you know, these 8 classes of lung cancer genome alterations, each targeted by a unique class of drugs, is a good example of that.
Absolutely, thank you. Misha, you work very closely on the profile program. I think Posse and Matthew have both mentioned that so far. Can you tell us a little bit more about what profile is and how it enables you to find the right treatments for the right patients?
Absolutely. I think, you know, many of the principles that Drs. Yane and Meyerson were talking about are things that we still think about today, but really 10 years ago when Profile was founded, it really was, I think, an example of the foresight that wasn't really actionable at that time. I mean, at the actionable genome was, there weren't that many targets across cancers, and you can see in lung cancer how much has changed, and that has happened across cancers. And so I think Profile is an example of a research program that early investment by philanthropy really created an infrastructure that allowed for routine sequencing of every patient here at Dana-Farber. And this, I think the concept of precision medicine, when you really try to learn from individuals, whether they be exceptional responses within clinical trials or identify specific treatments for an individual, does require numbers. And we've now sequenced almost 50,000 tumors within the Profile program. And so we've been able to learn about common cancers, but also less common cancers. And this work has fueled a lot of basic research to try to develop new targets and mechanisms of drug resistance. And so this is really a program that continues to evolve through the years. But back in 2011, when it was founded, it was really kind of the early idea that we shouldn't be just doing this on the research side, that we should be doing this in real time, whether or not we, you know, even had the drugs at that time. And since then, you know, there are certain things that have changed. I take care of prostate cancer patients, for instance, and it wasn't until, you know, last year that we started routinely sequencing prostate cancers universally because drugs are now approved. But we've been doing this for a long time here. And one thing that the Profile program does is it allows us to match patients with clinical trials, even extending beyond our cancer type. We have an infrastructure called MatchMiner, for instance, that will allow for patients and clinicians to really be alerted as to some of the innovative clinical trials that are being done here beyond, you know, our specific disease center. So I think it really is an example of a program that was initially focused on sequencing, but has had multiple iterations since then.
I think MatchMiner is a really great example of the the place that Dana-Farber sits at the edge of innovation for precision medicine. This is essentially a computer algorithm built in-house that allows us to take an individual's genetic information and to match them into clinical trials that are ongoing that will help them. And this is just part of the investment that Dana-Farber is making in using computational approaches to further precision medicine. Misha, could you say something about what we are embarking on this coming year, which is matched tumor normal sequencing?
Absolutely. So so Profile has been, as Matthew said, has been focused on genetic sequencing of cancers. There are a number of cancers that are sequenced to look for actionable targets across cancer types. We also know that there are inherited mutations in a patient's normal DNA that by sequencing both the tumor and the normal, you can improve your identification of alterations that are specific to the cancer. But we're also learning a lot about germline or inherited mutations that drive cancer initiation and may influence response to treatments. And so one of the major initiatives for the Profile program is to sequence not just the cancer, but also the normal DNA at the same time to maximize what we can learn and how we can act on a patient's genome. And that, of course, requires very close collaborations with our genetics team. And as we learn more about cancer risk through these types of programs, this also influences family members. And I think that this is actually changing the way we're even thinking about cancer screening and prevention strategies. So it goes, you know, beyond even acting on a patient's cancer when we start thinking about, at a broader scale, what this means for the community. So that's one big effort. And then I'm also happy to talk about Immunoprofile, which is another effort that has been integrated into the Profile program recently.
Please, go for it.
So, you know, the Profile program has focused on genomics over the years, but we know that targeted therapies that target mutations in a patient's DNA are not the only types of therapies we give to patients. We give chemotherapy, we give immunotherapy, and DNA alterations can influence response and resistance to multiple different types of drugs. But we also know that with immunotherapy, there may be features of the immune environment of a cancer that also can help us identify patients most likely to respond. So we've taken on a big effort to integrate not just genomic aberration, not to look not just at genomic alterations, but also the immune features of a patient's cancer and bring that back to patients and clinicians to help guide what the next treatment strategy might be in clinical trials. And I think it's just an example of how precision medicine is really moving to integrating multiple layers of information, extending beyond one thing and recognizing that there are many features of a patient's cancer that can influence response and resistance. And as we start thinking about new drug targets, it'll become more and more important to start thinking about other ways that we can learn about the molecular features or the biologic behavior of an individual.
Thanks, Misha. That's really great. Before we move on to questions that have been submitted by the attendees today, there's one final question that I'd like to get an answer from all of you, because I think everybody's perspective on this question is a little bit different. And the question is, what's next for precision medicine? Where is precision medicine going to be 5 years from now or 10 years from now? Posse, you want to take a crack at it?
Sure. So I think there are a couple of different pieces where in lung cancer, for example, this will be. And then as Matthew mentioned, the sort of subsets of lung cancer where one can have effective precision therapies is going to continue to increase here over the next several years. On the other hand, at the current time, we're treating each one of these subsets with a single drug. And I think what is going to happen over the next several years is transitioning from a single drug to a combination of therapies. And they can be deployed at sort of various instances or various places during care, making initial therapies work better or overcoming resistance, et cetera. The idea that if you inhibit cancers or treat cancers with multiple sort of complementary or non overlapping ways, the therapies can last hopefully longer and are much more effective. Something that, for example, many of us are familiar with how HIV is treated today with cocktails of therapies, or tuberculosis is treated today. And the same principles apply to precision therapies. The question is just what are the right partners to an effective therapy and when you deploy them? But I think that's an area where we're going to move and see more effective approvals over the next several years.
Thanks, Posse. Matthew?
Yeah, so I think that as Posse mentions, we're going to see big advances in therapy over the next 5 to 10 years and allowing us to treat more patients and get combinations. We're also going to see advances in diagnosis. And a lot of precision oncology is based on studies of the genome. And our ability to study the genome has increased enormously. And there are a couple areas of big advances happening right now. One is, as Misha referred to earlier, understanding the germline, right? What's, what can we learn about inheritance and inherited risk factors? A second is the ability to use what are called blood biopsies and actually see, what's in a patient's cancer without necessarily needing to biopsy the cancer directly. And that gives us a chance to look again and again at a patient's response to cancer during therapy. And the third area is going from studying part of the genome to studying all of the genome and to starting to be able to say, okay, now we're not just going to study the part that has known genes, we're going to be able to study everything and we're going to find all the alterations in a patient's cancer that can be important and start to expand that universe of alterations. And so I view those as the three key elements of how we're going to advance thanks to technology advances. And I think that's an area where Dana-Farber's traditionally been at the forefront of our ability to understand cancer through the genome. And I think we're going to continue to do that. I think the other, finally, beyond the genome, there's the piece that Misha referred to, starting to think about precision medicine in terms of what can we understand about the immune system? What can we understand about the actual response of the immune system to the cancer? And finally, what can we understand about, potentially growing cancer cells and studying their response in culture, other new technologies that we can envision being part of our precision medicine armamentarium. So deepening our understanding of the genome and going beyond the genome as really two important areas of development.
Thanks, Matthew. Misha?
Yeah, no, I agree with the points that were raised. I think that I think we're still at the beginning of precision medicine, even though we've moved a lot in the last 10 years, we still have a lot more to do. And I think that a lot of what we learned about the actionable or targetable genome has been in newly diagnosed patients, but cancers do evolve and change with time. And just like every patient with cancer is different, mechanisms of resistance also differ in different patients. And so, as Matthew mentioned, the ability to non-invasively detect resistance in patients will be important because doing repeat biopsies multiple times during a patient's cancer course can be invasive and not ideal. There's also advances in molecular imaging and other ways that we can start to detect resistance patterns. I do think that from a clinical standpoint, a lot of drug development happens in later stages of cancer. Moving those drugs earlier will help hopefully improve, decrease relapses, improve cure rates, and ultimately to defeat cancer, I think we need to intercept it at an earlier stage and we have more effective treatments. And then finally, I think that we're going to see a lot as far as drug development, and we already are seeing drugs that are being developed in a more rational way, not for every single patient, but enriching for patients most likely to respond. Some of these targets are not necessarily targeting DNA alterations, but are targeting multiple features. For instance, we're working on a trial in prostate cancer, a cancer that is not typically responsive to immunotherapy, but where you can have a drug that binds to the cancer and also brings in T cells to the cancer to bring in the immune system to a cancer that's not typically rich with immune cells. And so these are the types of innovative approaches that we are going to see to try to change the way cancers respond to drugs that they may not have responded to in the past.
Maybe just add one sentence to that in what Misha mentioned was that most of the precision therapy in lung cancer and other cancers is in patients with advanced disease, and incorporating these into earlier stages of disease. This is just at the infancy in lung cancer, but we're already clearly seeing the benefits of that. And I think that that will help and allow us to cure more patients who are diagnosed with earlier stages of disease.
Thanks, guys. I'd like to take my own crack at this question, actually, and I'd like to talk about undruggable targets. In my laboratory, we work on an oncogene called KRAS, and KRAS was identified in the late 1970s, and up until just the past few months, people have thought that there's no way we'll ever make a drug to this mutant gene. And as Posse mentioned briefly, in some of his earlier remarks, we just saw FDA approval of the first drug to target mutant RAS. And so I suspect that in 10 years, there will be no gene that we will consider undruggable. And that is will come from a better understanding of the biology of those cancer-causing mutations and the in the mutant proteins that come from them, also enhancement of our ability to do chemistry, as Posse also mentioned. And I think that, as Misha mentioned, we really are in the early days of precision medicine. In the profile program, we measure mutations in a couple hundred genes. There's only a couple dozen genes that have drugs associated with them. So we collect an awful lot of information that actually is not deployed clinically because we don't have the right drugs yet. And I suspect 10 years from now, as our toolkit of cancer drugs expands exponentially, we'll be in a much better position to choose effective therapies for all of our cancer patients. Okay, let's move on to some of the questions that we received from our attendees. We've touched on this a little bit. We've talked about resistance. We've talked about not having enough drugs. Could we address a little more, in a little more granular level, what are the roadblocks to precision medicine right now? For an individual patient that comes into your clinic, what are the reasons why you might not be able to give them a precision medicine? Posse?
Well, I think part of it is that is kind of what Matthew alluded to, is that when we do our genetic analysis at the moment, we are only studying a subset of the genome, and we're only studying genetic alterations, not other types of alterations. And so, for example, patients come in who have developed resistance to a particular targeted therapy, and we do our current generation of analysis, and we don't find a targetable alteration. Or we find an alteration for which we do not have a drug. And so these still represent challenges as to how to best treat such a cancer, what are the actual mechanisms that are leading to resistance, and how can we develop approaches to overcome that? That may be from an incomplete understanding of resistance with our current tools that are in the clinic, and by expanding our toolkit or genetic analysis and transcriptome analysis and proteomic analysis, you may be able to get a more comprehensive picture and direct the therapies that may be effective in that individual, or recognize that we're missing a class of therapies that we need to develop to overcome resistance.
Posse, could you talk about EGFR as an example of how we've gone from first generation to second generation to third generation drugs, and based on what we've learned about the evolution of cancers in response to treatment?
Sure. So it's also important to recognize that EGFR inhibitors were discovered before EGFR mutations. And so the inhibitors were generated to be, as Misha mentioned, more broader inhibitors of cancers, not specifically of EGFR mutant cancers. And subsequently was discovered that they happened to work particularly well, but that doesn't mean that they were the best medicines for the mutation. They just happened to work well in that situation. Now, we subsequently clinically and preclinically recognized that there are specific mutations to those early generation medicines. And that happened to be a relatively unique example because there was one dominant mutation that accounted for the vast majority of resistance. And that subsequently led to a series of preclinical studies that I was fortunate to work with Nathaniel Gray, who was a medicinal chemist at the Dana-Farber, to ask the question, if we now know that there's an EGFR mutation and this resistance mutation, could we now identify agents that were specific against that, not against the normal form of EGFR? And that led to a precursor molecule, which ultimately led and inspired a lot of the pharmaceutical industries to develop clinical versions of these compounds. And in the EGFR field, this led to a medicine called osimertinib or Tagrisso, which is now widely used. And it had the advantage that it was effective against the EGFR mutants, but it spared inhibition or was selective against the wild type form of EGFR, which is found in your normal skin and gut and things like that, which led to much of the toxicity of the earlier generation drugs, which is now spared significantly by using this mutant selective next generation inhibitor. So I think that was a good example of studying what happens in patients, studying preclinical models, again, bringing people together from different disciplines, from medicine, from science, from chemistry, from biochemistry, all looking at the same question and then coming up with an answer together. And I think that's the power of working together and bringing people from different disciplines together, which I think it makes Dana-Farber a unique place.
Misha, your clinical expertise is in a disease for which there are fewer precision medicines available. What do you see as barriers for your patients?
So prostate cancer doesn't have as many mutations as some other types of cancers. And what we know about prostate cancer is there's a smaller number of recurrent alterations, but what we call sort of this long tail of the curve, which are less frequent mutations present less frequently across individuals, but potentially biologically important. And it hasn't been until recently where we've had sort of the numbers needed in, first of all, prostate cancer has a long natural history. So we typically have to, we see patients in the clinic treating them often many years before their initial diagnosis. So that's another barrier. I think it's been challenging to try to delineate the targetability of some of the mutations in prostate cancer. We have made advances. We have two classes of drugs that are approved based on the presence of genomic aberrations, which makes sequencing more commonly done now, which was not the case before. A lot of my research focuses on treatment resistance, and similar to other cancers like EGFR-driven lung cancers, where you have an effective targeted therapy, resistance mechanisms can lead to mutations of that target. And in prostate cancer, the main driver is the androgen receptor. So one big challenge in the prostate cancer space is that we get overactivity of the androgen receptor. So a lot of the drug development is trying to figure out better ways to target that key driver. And that's where some innovative approaches such as protein degraders and things like that are starting to make a difference as you start progressing after multiple lines of androgen receptor targeted drugs. Then in some cases, which we've been particularly interested in, is that the mutations stay the same, but the resistance mechanisms are epigenetic. These are things that are not often captured clinically because we don't see them on our DNA platforms. And this is another class of drugs that we're very interested in trying to target resistance and prevent resistance using another way to target specific subclasses of prostate cancer that may be non-genomic.
Thanks. Matthew, you talked a bit about diagnosis in the future of more diagnosis and precision medicine. Are there technical barriers to developing new diagnostic assays right now?
Yeah, so I think there are technical barriers and there are also technical opportunities. When I started at Dana-Farber, the first human genome was being sequenced at a cost of well over $1 billion. And now the cost is $1,000. So just imagine if we had the same drop in the price of, say, housing costs in the Boston area. You know, imagine where we would all be living today. And, it's one of those things that it means that we can understand a lot more about the genome. Just going to give an example from prostate cancer evolution, and then I'm going to talk a little bit about technical barriers. So an example from prostate cancer is one of the main targets, as Misha mentioned, is the androgen receptor. And one of the mechanisms that we found work of Srini Vishwanathan, and a young oncologist at Dana-Farber, together with Mary Ellen Taplin, one of Dr. Beltran's colleagues, is that you get genome events that are near the gene but outside the gene. The kind of thing that you can only find by whole genome sequencing, where you get activation of a control element outside the gene. So we now have the opportunity to start finding some of these types of elements. What are the barriers? Our biggest barrier is in what we call informatics or data science. It's being able to understand, okay, these are the events in the genome. What do they mean? How do we analyze them computationally? And it's that computational analysis that is our biggest technical barrier right now to understanding the genome going forward. And I think that really investing in the data science aspect is key. The second piece is there are a lot of new technologies coming. There's constant innovation in genomic technology, and it's really doing the benchmarking and the troubleshooting and the analysis of these technologies, which one's going to carry us the further, and trying to figure that out. And I think that's the second barrier. And then the third barrier is kind of a clinical information barrier. And this is where I think an institution like Dana-Farber is unique, because through the profile program and through the types of data analysis and correlative science, right, we can say, what's the clinical meaning? And that's where that communication between scientists and physicians that I mentioned earlier is really key to progress. And that's, you know, one of our own unique features here at Dana-Farber.
Thank you. Posse, we mentioned combination therapy a little bit. Can you talk a little bit about the role that combination therapy will play in the future of precision medicine?
Sure. So I think that comes in two flavors. One is a sort of combination targeted therapy, what we're talking about when we talk about the different subsets of genetically altered lung cancers, where one therapy may be effective, but it may have ultimately limitations, and how to develop or add a second therapy to make that effectiveness last even longer. And so that's one approach. The other approach is a combination of immune therapy. So different categories of immune therapies that can be administered together. And there are some approvals of those that already exist in melanoma as well as in lung cancer, harnessing different components of the immune therapy. And then trying to understand where there are intersections between either targeted therapy or immune therapies with other therapies that we can more conventionally use, chemotherapy, radiation, other therapies, and trying to come up with this sort of combinatorial approach that's of course effective, but also tolerable over long periods of time.
Misha, could you talk about how one might use profile to determine what the best combination therapy might be for a certain patient?
Yeah, you know, I think that there are, you know, I think that using the information to understand not just drivers, but also potential resistance pathways to target that in a more rational way can be useful. I think leveraging data from other cancer types to inform combination strategies can also be helpful. It's also important to note that cancer mutations are not the same in every cancer type. So we do need to do the trials to figure that out because, we are seeing more trials that are based on genomic aberrations that are exploring combination strategies. There's the combo match trial, which is through the NCI. But even at our institute, through our early drug development program, we're seeing, you know, rational combinations. And I think that's the key, is that, you know, it's really based on some scientific rationale to combine the drugs. And as you know, a lot of combination approaches have been limited by toxicity in the past, but to try to either prime response to another agent or figuring out that dosing, it can be challenging, but something that I do think will ultimately make a bigger difference if we can prevent resistance or target non-redundant pathways, we could get more effective responses.
Thanks. One last thing I want to talk about, and this is again a question that came in from one of our attendees. The work that we talk about here that we do at Dana-Farber is certainly not specific to Dana-Farber. A lot of academic medical centers are investing heavily in precision medicine. How do we reduce duplication of the efforts, and or how do we cooperate with other places to push ahead the field of precision medicine? Matthew, could you start?
Sure. I think this is a really great question. And Dana-Farber is actually part of a consortium called the Project Genie that's together with the American Association for Cancer Research. And in this Genie consortium, several different cancer research and treatment institutes like ourselves have joined together to share our precision medicine data. And so this includes ourselves, Memorial Sloan Kettering, MD Anderson in Texas, Vanderbilt in Tennessee, and others. And by sharing these data, we're able to pool this information on the combination of patients' genome alterations in their cancers and their treatment responses, and really enable joint research on some of these questions. And so this is one way that we're doing it. It's not really so much duplication of effort, it's collaboration of effort.
But one thing I mentioned about Project Genie as well is that the special thing about it is its sheer size. No one single academic medical center can collect really all of the information that we need to do the sophisticated types of analyses that we need to do. And so it's cooperation between academic medical centers that really make things like Project Genie special. Go ahead, Misha.
I was just going to comment that I also agree that having large data sets that are really important for informing the science and collaboration is really critical. But I also think that precision medicine is caring for an individual. And so, you know, having the ability to do that for each patient, I don't see as redundant if it's happening in multiple institutions, because, you know, that is a meaningful thing for the individual. And so I do think that it's not just about sequencing cancers, it's really about applying that information to clinical care as well. And that's where I think Dana-Farber really does excel, and that we do have the science and the trials to offer.
And maybe just to add to both of these is that, you know, by working with other centers that are also doing precision medicine, you know, in a field like lung cancer, where we have rare genetic subsets of individuals, to be able to conduct a clinical trial of sufficient size, we need of some of these rare subsets, which ultimately may lead to an approval of a new drug, we do need to collaborate with our colleagues at different centers, and have done that consistently. And in that way, everybody benefits, most importantly, the patients.
Absolutely. I think that's a really good point. I want to thank everybody for the questions that they asked. And for some of you, we didn't have time to answer your questions. We will follow up individually with you with answers to your questions. I also want to express my extreme gratitude to the panelists. It's always inspiring to hear you guys talk, and your expertise is unparalleled. I'd like to also thank people, the individuals who have continued to support the work of our faculty in making all of our research possible. There was one question that came in, how can one help get involved in this area? Well, that's an excellent question. And the truth is, we really need your help. And so, you know, as I mentioned, precision medicine is really the future of cancer medicine. But as Misha mentioned very clearly, we're really right at the beginning of the field of precision medicine. And so the Dana-Farber has recently announced an ambitious multi-year fundraising effort to raise $2 billion to prevent, treat, and defy cancer. And the campaign is divided into several different focus areas. One is revolutionary science, which you've heard a lot about in this panel discussion. Our research at Dana-Farber is cited 2.5 times more than any other cancer center in the United States. And that was precisely what I was talking about when I was at the beginning talking about how fantastic our faculty are. Our faculty have also started 51 biotech companies out of their research, which is a way for us to take the research that we do in our institute and get it to patients faster. And we also, Dana-Farber has a direct connection to 41 of the last 100 drugs to be approved by the FDA for cancer. So still, as I mentioned, there are many drug targets that we don't have drugs for yet. And this is why we need our revolutionary science. We're also focused on extraordinary care. You've heard a lot about care, both from the doctors and from a patient tonight. And we're working to deploy more of our resources to expand telemedicine, something that has come into focus during the COVID pandemic, to couple diagnosis with precise therapeutics. We've talked an awful lot about that today. And to extend our reach by improving access to cancer therapy for underserved communities. And this is really a promise that the Institute is making to put patients and their loved ones at the center of everything we do. Third is our exceptional expertise, and really our the people that work for Dana-Farber are the linchpin for our success. And we want to jumpstart the careers of oncologists and scientists who are just starting out. We want to give our clinicians the resources they need to spend more time with their patients and to reach communities that are hardest hit by cancer, as I mentioned, those underserved communities. And we want to provide our researchers with the support that allows them to pursue high risk, high reward studies that don't really get funded through federal funding. This is what I was referring to when I said that our institute recognizes the financial barriers to research innovation. It's research innovation that leads to new precision therapies. And finally, we want to raise funds for what we consider essential opportunities. And these are unrestricted funds and gifts to the Jimmy Fund that allow us to be nimble and rapidly address the most pressing needs and promising opportunities that arise spontaneous through the course of the campaign. Such as our ability to seize on a new discovery that's made by one of our faculty members, to form a new team of investigators that are working together to develop a precision medicine, for example, or to recruit an amazing talent from around the country that we really want to come to our institution and to help our patients. So all of you can get involved in helping to move the campaign forward and to advance our research, like the research you've heard about today. You can make a philanthropic donation at the Dana-Farber Cancer website, devicancer.org. You can donate blood or platelets at our Kraft Family Blood Donor Center. You can continue to participate in our educational seminars like the one today. And you can share our mission to defy cancer on your social media platforms. And you can participate in Jimmy Fund fundraisers to help raise support for Dana-Farber. I want to again thank you all for coming and participating in our forum today. And I want to remind you that we have this CSO forum twice a year. The next one will be sometime in the fall. So keep a lookout for that. Again, everybody will be able to rewatch this program with a link that we will send to you afterwards. And again, I want to thank our panelists for their really insightful thoughts on precision medicine. Thank you, everybody, for coming.